morning, for those of you who are viewing, and this is a favor actually for the ELCA and for Dave Dalbert and myself. One thing we don't know as a church actually is an average of how many people we have per screen throughout the church. So I'd ask right now if you would, just in the message part on Facebook Live, just say how many people are actually viewing on your particular screen. So if you have three people, write three, and if you have four, four, one, one. But just give us a number if you would, please. This is somewhat unscientific, but it's the best science we have right now. So thank you. And I'd invite us to pray. Gracious God, bless us. Bless us here and now. Bless us as we are and wherever we are. Bless us now as we ponder your word. Bless us that your word would challenge us, change us, transform us. Make us anew to be who we really are meant to be. In Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Amen. I think if we're honest with ourselves, I think there's always something that we're afraid of in this life. And you know, it's always sort of funny. My dad would tell me when I was a kid not to be afraid of the dark, but when I grew up, I discovered he was afraid of closed-in spaces. And if I'd known that as a child, I would have found every opportunity to ride elevators, but I was a little bit slow on that one. But we all have fears, don't we? Things that we worry about, things that might keep us from doing things. And I will add, some fears actually serve a really good purpose. There are times where fear tells you not to do something you shouldn't do. And there are times, perhaps, where we might be wise to be more afraid. But I will add, where fear becomes a problem is when fear keeps us from living as we are called to live. And sometimes fear will keep us from doing something that we really want to do, that we feel called to do, and it's fear that holds us back. When I was in my 40s, I'd been running on and off for years, and I thought about it for years, that I wanted to try to run in a 5K race, and I never would actually sign up. I would train, and then what I would do is, shortly before the race, I would always come up with some way to have an excuse not to run. And so I never actually ran. And it came down to this. There were two things I was afraid of. And the one was that I would start a race and I wouldn't be able to finish. And I hated that thought, that I would start a race and that all these people would be running and I wouldn't be done and I wouldn't finish and I would walk. Which I've since then discovered most people walk at some time or another. But the other fear I had was that I would finish the race, but I would do really badly. And by the way, that one was about ego, pride. And neither one of those was really a good reason not to run a race. So what eventually happened is I had a friend who knew that I wanted to run, and he had run a whole bunch of races. So he said to me, I'll run with you, and I'll run beside you every step of the way. And that's exactly what he did. In fact, the day of the race, we got started, and he said, I bet you're ready for this. And as we were running, I said, no, I'm not. And he said, you are. And he ran beside me the whole way, and he coached me. He reminded me to do basic things like one foot in front of another and breathing. Things that I knew for myself, but in my anxiety, I might have forgotten. And so the powerful thing was that I finished the race. And after that, I found that I could run many races, and I have over the years run all sorts of races, and sometimes I run alone, but more often, whenever possible, I love to run with friends. You know, when you run a race with a friend, there's this powerful thing that happens. You get in step with each other, and your breathing might even become synchronized as you run. But it's a great way of bonding. But here's what I would notice, is that my fear had kept me from doing it. But I discovered that friendship in this case was stronger than fear. And I've since discovered also, by the way, that most first-time racers are nervous about running for the first time. And I think most of us are nervous about all sorts of things that we might have for the very first time. If you think about it, think of the firsts in your life. You know, the first time you left home. The first time you left home without your parents. For some people, the first time flying could be traumatic. I might add, for some people, the second time flying could be traumatic. But think of the things that have frightened us over the years. The first day of school, the first day in a new job. I'll add, you know, the first days of falling in love and how exciting and frightening that can be. And I'll even say, you know, the first days when Janice and I were married were wonderful, but I was also terrified because I had no idea what I was getting into. First things can be frightening, but I will also say so could last things. And this past year, it was so sad that we didn't have the end of a school year the way we usually would have. But I remember being a kid and having that last day of school. And there was always something bittersweet and a little bit frightening because we would leave and we would know that we might come back the next year, we might be graduating, but we knew that we would never be in the same place in the same way with the same people again. You think of the end of a relationship, and even if it's gone very sour, it's this sadness and this fear at the end of a relationship, and there's a fear on the last day of work before retirement, or the last day before you move, there's this fear. And so it's pretty amazing if you think of it, that our lives, we have all sorts of things to make us anxious and afraid, and beginnings can be hard, endings can be hard, I might add middles can be hard too. Maybe life is hard some days, but I would say this. We have all sorts of things that we could potentially be afraid of. And if fear keeps us from doing something foolish and keeps us alive, that's wonderful. But if fear keeps us from living our life as God intended, that is trouble. This morning, we heard a reading from John's Gospel. And I will like to suggest that in many ways this is a story of first things and last things. And perhaps the last things are more obvious, that Jesus had had what we call a Last Supper with his disciples before his crucifixion. This is actually the last time they'll be together before Jesus dies and is raised. And there's a sadness to that, because they'll never be together in exactly the same way again. This is Jesus' last teaching, his final words. And in fact, if you look, this is part of the longest speech Jesus gives anywhere. And it's almost as if he doesn't want to leave anything out in these final last words. And it is, in many ways, the last time the disciples will be able to see Jesus with them in exactly the way that they have known him. And there is grief, even in the midst of promise. It is also a night of first things, I will add, however, because Jesus has been speaking for quite some time that the Spirit, his Spirit, is coming to dwell with these disciples. And he says, in fact, that is even better than his physical presence, because the Spirit will be with them forever. And while Jesus could be limited to a specific place at a specific time, the Spirit can be anywhere, everywhere at once. It is also the first time these disciples are going to be set out to actually be the witnesses to what they've seen and heard, and that they're going to be the ones who will do greater works than Jesus through the power of Jesus. And you realize that's a frightening thing. Think of the responsibility that they're now the ones. If they give forgiveness, people get it. If people are healed through them, they're healed. And if they don't
do what they're called to do, the gospel will not go forward.
Well, actually, it will. But they don't know that yet. It's a story of first things, last things, and this is what happens in the story. Jesus is teaching his disciples not to be afraid. Or at least not to let fear be greater than their faith. Or allow fear to be greater than their friendship with one another. Because they're not meant to do this alone. The gospel today, you know, you read John's gospel out loud, and this is one of the things that frightens preachers, because John's gospel can be like a tongue twister. And, you know, I and you and you and me and I and the Father, and sometimes you hear it and it sounds so confusing, but really it's so simple. And I'll give it to you. Basically, there are two things that Jesus says. And the first thing that he says, as far as assurance, is that I will not leave you orphaned, says Jesus. Jesus says, I return to the Father, but I will also send to you the Spirit of truth. And if Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, as he has already said, then the Spirit is the Spirit of truth, the Spirit of life, the Spirit who shows us the way forward. And Jesus also says, he says, I am in you, and you are in me, and the Spirit is in you. And Jesus says, I go to the Father, and the Father loves you. Do you notice what's going on? That in the midst of the new, in the midst of the old, in the midst of everything in between, it is the same promise that it was in the beginning. God is with you. The other thing that brackets this reading is a word of love. Jesus says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. You will love one another. And later he says, those who keep my commandments love me. And the Father loves them, and I will love them. Do you catch what's going on here? That the command really is that simple, that we love one another. Simple, not always easy, but that we love. We love God, we love one another, and we discover that whether we can love or not, God loves us still. So there it is, the gospel. Two things today. God is with you. God loves you. And God calls us to love one another. So we do find ourselves in this strange season, don't we? And one of the things that I notice, I stand in front of the altar, and ordinarily we would be moving towards communion, but I would like to say this, you know, communion is this wonderful visible sign that God is with us. But you notice we're just like the disciples today, aren't we? That same Spirit, whether we have a visible presence of God or not, that same Spirit is with you and with me, wherever we are, whether we see each other or not. And so, we've been in this strange season, as I said, and I've been working from home, and it dawned on me a few weeks ago that I really had no excuse not to exercise every day. You know, when I travel, I have excuse. Tired, I flew or something, but I'm home and I'm working, and you know, I can work, I can run before work, I can run after work, I can do something every day, and so I have, and I decided that I'm training for a 5K, and that was great. I was having a good time training for the 5K and thinking about which 5K I was going to do, and you know, and by the way, it was good stuff. It was bringing back all sorts of memories, and it took me about 3 weeks to figure this out. Not the brightest guy in the world, but it took me 3 weeks to figure this out. There are no 5Ks. And there aren't going to be any 5Ks anytime soon, because think of this, we're not supposed to be breathing on each other. And you can wear a mask, but you get a few hundred people together, you bunch us together, you say run, and we all start breathing on each other. Can you see why they're not going to do that? So it took me 3 weeks to figure that out. I bet you figured that out in 15 seconds. So I confessed this as a lament, and one of my colleagues said, you know, there are virtual 5Ks. Well, here's how a virtual 5K works. You register online, and you record your results online, but you actually do run. You know, it's not, you don't get a virtual, you know, look at a computer screen. No, you actually run.
So I did. I decided, sure, let's do it. Because at least in the virtual 5K, there are other people running. We're all posting our times, and we all know that we're running towards something. And in this case, it was for COVID-19 relief. And so there are people all over the country, all over the world, who did the same race that I did. We all got to run in our own space and our own time, but we all did. You realize how powerful that is? That if I had run a traditional race, it would have been the people right there. In this so-called virtual race, we have to have a better name for it, really. But in the so-called virtual race, I got to run with people all over the country, all over the world. We got to run for a common cause, to care for our neighbors. There was something else, though, is when I did run my race, I wasn't really alone. God was with me, of course. But I also had the memory of all those friends of mine who I've run races with. And in a way, I could hear them in my ear saying, pace yourself, breathe, one foot in front of another. And it was great joy to remember that we really never, ever run this life or this race of faith alone. And you do not run this race of faith alone today. So throughout this season, I'd like to remind us once again that God loves us. God loves you as you are. If you're afraid, if you're faithful, God loves you. The other thing I would remind us is in all things we are called to discover that we are to love one another as God has first loved us, and that we really are never alone in this world. So here it is, what I will say today, finally. Remember who you are, and remember whose you are, and remember why you are today. And who you are a beloved child of God. Remember whose you are. You belong to God. No matter what, God will never lose you. Remember why you are. God has put you, put me, on this earth. And in this fellowship, he has put us together that we would learn to love God and love one another, encourage each other, and run the race set before us with courage and faith and love. Thanks be to God. Amen.